Hi, this is Maiko, and this is the As Told By Show here at ecavradio.com in Johnson County Community College in Overland Park, Kansas. We are happy to be spotlighting local talent, seeing as there's so much of it in the Kansas City area. Today, we are welcoming Stick Figure, one of KC area's local rap artists. Comes out of Topeka, Stick Figure is quickly building a reputation locally, nationally, and internationally as an upcoming rapper to keep an eye on. MTV featured Stick Figure with producer Odyssey in A Year in Selections from 2010. Stick Figure was first introduced to ECAV Radio by Joshua Browning, ECAV's Associate Manager of Music and Events. Josh also produces music for other local artists and has recently joined forces with Chris Cosgrove of Cosgrove Studios. Josh and Stick have bromanced together on such projects as From the Top and has directed the video. It's Stick Figure, man. We had a good time talking with Stick Figure and learning about what makes this stick tick. He says, I'm very well-rounded for being a square. Hey, let's join the conversation with Stick Figure, Josh, and me, Maiko, at ECAV Radio Studios now.
Stick Figure is potentially very important. I make records every day, and when I started working with my friend to my left here 2-something years ago,
been a while.
I knew that it was a special thing. I knew that it was really important and that he could be a big deal. And I don't talk about things like people being a big deal or people being famous or people doing anything like that.
If you know anything about Josh, doesn't care. Kanye West walking here right now, and if he was being a jerk, you'd tell him to sit down somewhere and shut his mouth. That's how Josh gets down.
It's true. And when I met this gentleman, I knew that it was an important thing. So I've been here to support him ever since. We got people outside the window taking pictures of us.
It's true. Already, the crowds are gathering. How did they know you were here? The paparazzi.
Yeah, man.
So, it's true. Josh is...
tough critic.
He's a tough critic, yeah. But, you know,
he can be really,
like, undercover about it. You don't know that it's going to come. But
that does not sound positive.
In those little slick remarks he's making, it's like something to let you know. I don't think too much of that. You know, so that's really something. And I might add that Josh is a producer here in the area and should know about
the music scene.
He runs out of a new company now. Can you tell us the name of your company?
The new company that I'm working with is called Cosgrove Audio. I'm partnering in with the amazing, wonderful, and friendly, and huggable, and lovable Chris Cosgrove, who, if you know anything about music in the area, then you know about Chris Cosgrove.
This is like really a pleasure and a treat to be able to spend some time in the studio with two guys who've been working together. They bestest friends, y'all. I've been wanting to say that. They are, what y'all call
that's
it?
That's my homeboy,
They got
man.
A bromance going. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, my.
Hey, it's all good. It's all good. You know that one, the kind where they act stupid together, and that's all. Okay, so.
All the good buddy movies.
Yeah, grumpy old men. I'm sure they got plenty of them stories to tell that they can't say in front of me because thank you. We heard about how you got your name, Stick Figure, and they're going to be making a cartoon out of it soon.
Very soon.
From your mother.
Hanna-Barbera.
Yes. I can't wait to see it. You know they should
do
that. You know you should be working on that.
Okay, I'm working on a line of clothes and everything, lunch pails, all of that.
Okay.
I mean, 10%.
You know, okay, all right.
10%.
So, here you were, a Stick Figure at home working for your mother, and she just wanted to cheer you up one day and have a little fun. But then, when did you first get interested in rapping?
That's kind of a long process because I wasn't initially into rap. Like, as a kid, like, I don't think any kid should be, not real rap. Like, let me be clear, not real rap. I was, like, listening to Criss Cross and stuff. But before it did, it was Ralph Tresvant and like, whatever my sister was listening to. So, I think I got officially interested probably in the 8th grade when I heard
when the MCs came, tell them about their names and to perform.
That album, a friend of mine, let me borrow it, because prior to that I wasn't into like lyrical or East Coast quote unquote rap music. I was more into like Bay Area and West Coast gangster stuff, but I couldn't entirely relate to it because I never shot nobody. So since I had never personally shot anybody, I was listening to this GZA record my friend Taiwan let me have, and I was like, oh man, this is something different. Like Wu-Tang Clan was like this like really like aggressive but smart, and the production was really weird, and I just kind of got into it. So from there, then the Fugees and things like that. So I'd probably say like age 13, and it's all GZA's fault. So if you hear my music and you're like, man, it sucks, you blame GZA.
Out of all that stuff that you were hearing back then, I know you used to copy it.
Oh, man. When I first actually wrote my first rap, my buddy Eric, Josh know Eric, but my buddy Eric accused me of sounding exactly like Corrupt from Dog Pound. It was really bad. Like, it sounded just like Corrupt. Like, I really wanted to be that guy really bad. So that's probably the first person I emulated to the point in, you know, ad nauseum. Like,
to be clear, though, there are many worse people to emulate than Corrupt from Dog Pound.
Definitely, but still.
So what did that sound like?
I don't, you don't want to hear that. You know what? He had a verse on a song called New York, New York. Like,
it's incredible, the lyrical. You can't be me like me. To see me, it's gonna take a miracle.
It's the lyrical, metaphysical, like type flow, like where everything was like 18 syllables within the rap. So that was kind of my thing for a while. Biting Corrupt.
So these were the guys that inspired you first?
Yeah, definitely.
It's incredible, the lyrical. You can't be me like me. To see me, it's gonna take a miracle.
You said that was around eighth grade?
Started
writing it then?
Yeah, I started writing it around eighth grade, but I didn't tell anybody.
I was about to say, what was going on? Were you writing poetry?
Private raps. Like, and none of it was about anything other than what I thought I was supposed to be rapping about, which was shooting people, which I mentioned prior. I had never shot anybody. So,
wait, did you actually write?
I wrote a rap.
Shoot people rhymes?
Yeah,
like,
I wrote hardcore.
When you were in eighth grade.
I wrote hardcore gangster rap in eighth grade.
An eighth grade Jehovah's Witness in Topeka,
exactly.
Kansas was writing about
hardcore.
Writing
and I'll tell you how real,
bad
how,
stuff.
How crucial it was is I put one of them in my pocket. My mom was washing my clothes, and she read one of them. And she was like, so we on the block getting it. Shooting at these, like, what's this? What is this? And I'm like, it's just. So I knew then that, like, something needed to change, that I still wanted to do it. But, again, it was still very private. Like, I had never, like, let anyone hear anything I ever did until way later, like, into high school probably.
How did that happen?
Good friend of ours, Martin Hess Hillard.
You guys, man, everybody
hey, Marty.
That you mentioned is like
friend of mine. It's all inclusive.
It's
man.
Family. This is the way we run things.
This is how we run things. It keeps things simple, and
we don't trust a lot of people.
Exactly. my paranoia probably supersedes everyone's. So like, but Martinez was this kid who's from my neighborhood. Not just some kids. One of my best friends who's from my neighborhood in Topeka, and He was also into rap, but it was me, him, Eric, and a guy named Mike Graham, and we started this thing called Freestyle Friday. This is before 106 and Park, though, and we used to all hang out in front of the high school and rap around this tree or whatever, and we were like, man, we should do the talent show. The Black Student Union had a talent show every year at Topeka High, and they're like, man, we should do the talent show. Marty's idea purely, I was too terrified, honestly. I was not into it. The whole idea of it was terrifying to me, but
Marty pushes all of us into things that we would otherwise not do, and then we thank him, for much, much later.
Yeah, yeah.
Does
absolutely.
He does.
In fact, this is the funny thing about Marty. I don't want to get too deterred, but Marty started out rapping, and I remember Marty to this day is still like one of my favorite rappers, and probably most intimidating like people to me, because he's such a like a poet laureate. Like, he's so like. He's like a novelist when it comes to rap. Like, I'm just rapping. Like, I'm listening to beats, and I'm trying to make this that sound jamming, and that's the end of it. But for Marty, Marty is, like, really, 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 really involved, like, you know, lyrically. So, like, and almost to like, I don't know, man. Some Hemingway, like, he's on something else with it.
It's pretty serious. He's been locked up in his room for about a year now. Just
power in the blood, brick and mortar in the veins. Oh. He says stuff like that. I don't say stuff like that.
Stuff that kind of hurts your brain a little bit.
Power in the blood, brick and mortar in the veins. He said, just like I just said it. Uh-huh. But anyway, I'm getting distracted. I'm sorry, I ramble. But
it's not a problem.
He was like, we should do the talent show, and we put together a song. And a buddy Mike, he had a friend who had a random beat. I don't even remember. It was really bad, though. But, like, the whole idea was, like, we're going to, again, Wu-Tang influence. Like, we're just going to Wu-Tang it. Like, no chorus. Like, we're going to go up there, spit 16s, and just do it. And again, it was, like I said, it was for the Black Student Union.
What's spit 16?
16 is in how you write raps in a 16-bar verse. So bar 16, generally chorus is 8 bars. So in rap, it's like, you know, we're just going to do 16s.
So give
each.
Me a 16.
You get 16?
I'm going to do a 16 right now.
Do a 16. Magnanimous, magnificent, rap lyricist, craft sentences with plans of a cash incentive. If that isn't it, I'm simply a black immigrant sharing white semen with women. I'm that chivalrous, just ask Millicent. I'm Sega, you never heard of me. Emergency surgery, leave walls plastered in burgundy, clear up the murder scene. Really a common courtesy. Chainsaws off into mercury, I did time for perjury. As cold as ice, vocal tones, microphones is my lone device, particular with the poems that I chose to write. It's a high watermark once exposed to light. I think that's 16. So that's the 16.
The whole thing?
That was 16.
That was 16 bars.
That was 16. So that's what we did.
For those who have just tuned in, that happens every day. He does that every day. Does that all the time.
So was that off the top of your head?
No, it wasn't. That was a written rap. But you asked for examples, so,
yes,
you know, in order to make sure that I was giving you 16 bars, I made sure to do that. So
thank you.
Yeah, so that's what we did, and I was like, man, I'm going to be a rapper.
All right.
But because we actually got a good reaction from BSU Talent Show, which was in
BSU
Black Student Union.
Okay.
So, like, to be up there, not because I mean, it's Topeka, and like everyone in Topeka is into.
Tell
like,
us about Topeka.
Topeka is this small town outside of Kansas City that no one in Kansas City knows exists, surprisingly, which is kind of weird. But if you ever get a ticket or something, or if you have to do anything government related, you have to come to Topeka. And I'm from that sleepy government town.
We just
noticed
went to Topeka.
What did you do there?
We were at a conference. I wasn't there, but ECAV Radio attended a conference in Topeka.
Okay, well that's boring. I'm sure it was boring.
No, they had a good time.
Did they have a good time? All right, good. Well, wonderful. But yeah, we had the BSU show, and people actually responded positively. So I was like, oh man, maybe I should rap. Like, I mean, it was just a thought. But I don't even think I recorded any music until 05, 06 with anyone. And there's only a few people that probably have heard any of that. Josh being one of them. Miles Bonney and a few others from here in Kansas.
Someday I'm going to sneak out all that early stuff.
Yeah, it's kind of... It's not bad.
Online, charge people
for it. I was thinking
it.
About that the other day. I was like, it's not terrible. I mean, I'm doper than Bow Wow was at that age. Like, so, it's cool.
Is that the watermark now? Is that the...
I mean, at that age, I wasn't as good as Nas at 16, but I was better than Bow Wow at 16.
I believe you.
He made a lot of money.
Just in the wrong place to pick up.
Exactly, exactly. That's exactly it.
It sounds like you weren't really rapping in front of people for that long then.
No. In fact, no. I was still too caught up in making sure that it wasn't terrible. Like, I just didn't want it to be unfinished, and, like, I didn't want people to, like, hear me not ready. So, like, I mean, the first actual show I did was in Memphis, which is my, you know, hometown. And, I went back to see my folks and had a friend named the Mighty Quinn. That's not his real name, but that's what I'm going to call him on radio. But the Mighty Quinn, and he was a friend of mine. He was like, man, you should do one verse during my set. But, all right, cool. So I did this rough version of a song I had called Tomfoolery, which is, it's all right. But anyway, like I did that, and no one threw tomatoes at me. So I was like, all right, well, you know, I'm going to keep working on it. Like I still wasn't all the way convinced. By the time I got back out here, from being down south, I was like, all right, let me see what's gonna happen. Let me give it a shot, and it's been working out pretty good. And I think the first thing I put out was called The Skinny, and that was in, when was that? Might have been 09. Wow, I haven't really been at this very long.
You really haven't.
When I think about it, now that she's making me chronologically go through it, like the first thing I put out was like The Skinny, and that came out 09, and then like another, yeah, Ain't Easy Being Skinny, that was 09.
So really?
Yeah, if you look it up on Google, I think it says 09, like the one with
I believe
Mike Wax.
We will take your word. Oh, yeah, that one. Yeah, that was definitely 09, because that's when we met, and it came out right then. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Wow.
Because that was the first stuff we recorded.
Yeah.
And it's on there, yeah.
So then y'all met in the studio.
Yeah. And that was even still, like, what happened with that was I won the Farmer's Ball, which wasn't supposed to happen. I'm convinced that wasn't supposed to happen.
The Farmer's Ball.
And the Farmer's Ball is just a battle of the bands that takes place in Lawrence every year since.
Every year. Man, who knows how long that's been going.
However long, forever. I was the only rapper on the thing. I think a moment that happened with that was I'm, you know, again, rapping, and I didn't have a DJ or anything yet, and my CD skipped during the performance. So instead of, like, freaking out and being like, oh, man, my CD skipped, I can't do nothing, like, I just did the rest of my set a cappella. And I was like, oh, I'm for sure going to lose. Like, it's over with. And then I won that round. And then I got to do another round at the Bottleneck, and I won that. And then I won the whole thing, which was crazy. And then the prize was Josh Browdy and like a gang of t-shirts or something and buttons.
Wait.
But like, he was the prize. No, for real. Like, the prize was, well, I guess I should have put it that way. But like, the prize is Josh. Look, no, the prize was, how much studio time was it?
Yeah. I think it was 2 days worth of studio time.
2 days worth of studio time with
the tall
awesome,
guy.
With the awesome Josh Browning at Black Lodge recording. So I was like, man, I'm out. Yeah, I was with it. And then we met, and then I started actually recording music. I was recording a record with Odyssey, and I was simultaneously recording a record with Seven.
Yep.
And I think that's pretty cool because both of those guys are, you know,
kind of a big deal
kind
these
of a
days.
Big deal. I'm still figuring it out as far at that point. Yeah.
Now you know that it really hasn't been that long.
Yeah, I know, because I mean, I get so stressed out. Like, I talk to this Josh guy every day, pretty much, or every other day. And I'm like, man, what am I doing? Like, this is not working, or I'm not winning right now, or it's not what it's supposed to be. But like, when you recount it, dang, John, you just aren't being patient. Like, you guys are getting me on tape saying all that. I wasn't thinking this prior to coming in the room.
Yeah, it just occurs to you every once in a while.
But it just kind of occurred to me. I was like, man, it hasn't been that long. You know, it may feel like longer because you've cared longer. You know, you've cared or had a passion for something for a long time. But the actual work hasn't started. It hasn't been that long. So I'm actually kind of doing all right.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it seems like it.
To think about it, like saying it out loud now, it's like, oh, man, not too bad.
When you first performed, what did it feel like?
When I first performed, I was just so nervous.
Did you
I
throw
wanted
up?
To get it over with. I didn't throw up.
No.
I didn't throw up. You would think I would throw up. The second time, funny enough, the second time I performed, I threw up. Because the first time I performed, it was kind of like, that's a bad metaphor. I'm not going to use a sex metaphor. But that's just the closest thing I could think of.
I understand.
Because you play music, so you get it. And you're a band.
That
so
was the second time.
You get it. No, the first time was like that. It's like the first time that happens. But the second time, because I just wanted to get it done. I was like, man, I want to do this. I want to get over with. I want to see how good it feels. And then I want to get out of the way.
That's nothing like sex.
That's what I'm saying. I didn't want to continue it like the sex thing. So I'm just saying, the first time, I just want to get up there, get out the way, not mess up. Boom. But the second time, it was like, I had a set. It was like, is it your set? You're going to perform. And I'm like, oh, man. Like, it was Blackalicious show in Lawrence.
Wow. That's the second time you ever performed?
Ever.
You really have not been doing this very long.
No.
You said I was bestest friends.
I didn't know him then. I did not know him.
He didn't know me then.
I didn't know him.
But that's where the buzz started around the town. Like, it was because of the Blackalicious show. But I was so nervous. I went in the bathroom. Earl came back. But it was packed. Like, it was bottleneck. People wall to wall, sweat on the ceilings type of show. And I just did it, and it worked, and everybody was with it.
How long was
I just did what I wanted, 20 minutes, and it was all songs I'll never do again. So whoever was there that night is lucky. I'll never do any of them songs ever again in your whole life. Yeah, and it was just so dope, though, because everyone was just with it. Like, everything I told them to do, they did it. I was like, oh, man, I'm cool on stage. Like, Fool Stick, you know what I mean? Like, I'm all right on this stage, too. So, like, it was just, you know, that was building the confidence. I got fortunate to get in front of a crowd that was receptive. Like, they didn't come into it arms folded, like, this will probably suck. They were like, no, we're here to have a good time. This will be fun. And then it worked out, so.
I didn't know that it had been only just recently that you were doing all these different things and making music and all that. I found out about you because of a class that I had with Josh.
Really?
He was doing his video project on you. And he was hour after hour.
On the Mario Kart.
That's the Mario Kart video. Yeah.
And we were like, what is he working on?
I'm back to my old self again, baby. Figure back. You rockin' with Elite, let's get it poppin' and compete. Don't care about the top because it's knocking in the street. Yeah. Sample more than idolers, I prosper with the beat. I can spit it into garlic or Islamic for the sheiks. You synonymous with weak, so be cautious and retreat. All mamas, I'm a beast, on your honor, I'm a ski. I'll ski, and then leave it in your keys. Keep the logic of a Vulcan, but the Romulans might fleet me.
And then finally, we started seeing some of it, and he mentioned your name, and I was like, Stick Who? And when he finished, it was, you know, it was a pretty nice video. We all kind of got into it. He had, like, now that you've been doing the music, and what do you think you're going to go from here? What do you think is going to happen next?
My only goal right now is to just make it and make sure as many people can hear it that should. And I think if I focus on that and all of the other stuff will not, it won't just fall into place. It still takes work. But I think I'm still in stages where it just needs to be ready for everyone. And as long as more people are becoming aware, like, because the methods that, and that's the thing, like, I'm kind of, like, I'm 28. So when I was coming up, we always thought that
you're supposed to lie about your age.
I'm 25.
You're supposed to be.
I'm 22.
You're 22.
Oh, I'm 21.
Okay. He just turned 21. Everybody buy him a drink when you see him out. He just turned 21,
everybody. Yeah, no, chop it up.
You don't know. People out there don't know about stage age. That's the whole thing. Somebody told me that.
So y'all go ahead and cut that up. Y'all cut that part out.
Yeah, we'll cut that part out. Don't worry.
And then I'll just say this. This is the phrase I'll use.
Okay.
I come from a generation when.
It's Stick Figure, babe. It ain't easy being skinny. It's me and Mike Wax, you know.